just want to thank Amy very much for having me. Can we give her a round of applause, please? I'm Robert. I'm going to play some classical piano and talk about it. And at the end, I'll play gospel by special request. I see a lot of familiar faces. Been substituting a bit at the Elon Community Church. Dr. Future, so it's an old friend. So I guess, can I take this off when I talk? Oh, okay. I'm not sick anymore. I was a month ago, but I'm doing an odd program right now, and it's based on the violin. So I'll tell you a story. I like to tell stories, maybe too much. So during the pandemic, I watched a documentary called The Art of Violin. It's a PBS documentary. It's free on YouTube. I can't recommend it enough. And I watched these great violinists of the past, like Yasha Heifetz, Nathan Milstein, Yehudi Menuhin, and I just said to myself, I want to switch instruments. And the piano is bulky, and always wanted to, and you know, the piano, it's very hard to make it sound like a human voice. Violin can sing and talk to you and sing. So I told my wife, who's also a pianist, she's a musician, I told her the next day about my plans. And she said, okay. But she had that look, you know. I said, what are you really thinking? She said, I know somebody who did something like that, and it took years and years and 15 hours of practice a day, and you know, probably not worth it. And we just had our first kid at that time. So I said, yeah, that's right. I was kind of despondent about it, but I came up with a plan B, which was to do violin repertoire arranged for the piano. There's a lot of very good arrangements. And then I thought it would just be a few pieces, but it's turned into several programs. And so that's what I'm doing now. I'm pretending to be a violinist on the piano. So, but I want to start with a piece that's frequently played on the violin. By the way, allowed various things to count, not just original violin pieces, but also, like this one is originally a song, it's a folk song from Japan. It's called Song of the Seashore by Narita Tamezo. And Narita Tamezo was a violinist also. There's a photo of him with a violin, and many violinists like to play it. So I'm playing it in my own version. It's quite different from the original. Because the larger point here is the question of musical arrangement. It's like translation. You read a translation of any literature, poems or whatever. Good translation has to not be verbatim. It's not Google Translate. It has to be reimagined, rethought. So I was talking to a person who played violin, and they told me, I loved your program, but some of the things were excruciating. I said, yeah, because you know the originals, and they're different, a different piece. So, anyway, this is Narita Tamezo's Song of the Seashore. If I were to sing, which you don't want to know about that, but the lyrics, it's a man walking along the seashore, very nostalgic, remembering the past, commenting on it. So, start with that, it's a shorter piece. Thank you. Another mellow piece, don't be so not so mellow. This is actually originally a piano piece, but you frequently hear it on the violin, so I figured, well, that counts too. See, it started with just strictly violin arrangements and veered into this territory. So, this is a piece called May Breezes by Felix Mendelssohn. Certainly not what we're experiencing right now. Felix Mendelssohn, born in 1809, was from what's now Germany. I think it was Saxony at the time. He was, in the words of a teacher I had, he was more Mozartian than Mozart himself, meaning that Mozart, and this is not to criticize Mozart at all, who was such a genius, but Daddy Mozart helped a lot with some of the early things. They found that Leopold really helped a lot. But Mendelssohn, not so much. He was just a fully formed musician that I don't know how old, four? It's just remarkable. Sadly, he lived a very short life, like Schubert and Mozart before him. He didn't reach 40. And, you know, what I especially love about Mendelssohn is that I feel the warmth of his personality. I feel like he wears his heart on his sleeve. You feel it in music, very honest. That's how I would describe this. Of course, this is just typical German romanticism, Schubert, Schumann, it's the same, you know, vein. When I play this, I also imagine I'm in one of those 19th century houses, even in this country. There's just a feeling of that, or Emily Dickinson's poems or something. There's all kinds of, you know, connections. What else would I say? It's called May Breezes. It's a nickname because the left hand is emulating the sound of soft spring, breezes. These arpeggios. And it's Fritz Kreisler, I believe, who arranged it for violin, and that's where you normally usually hear it. So I love old recordings, Fritz Kreisler and all these people. I'll talk about them probably a bit too much, but anyway, here's the next piece, Mendelssohn, May Breezes. Thank you. it's arranged by Sergei Rachmaninoff, the Russian composer. It's a gavotte from the third partita, and it's originally it's for solo violin, and Rachmaninoff creates this piano piece out of it, solo piano piece. I'll tell you a couple stories about both composers. They lived at very different times. Bach was born in 1685, died in 1750. Rachmaninoff lived from 1873 to 1943. Usually I don't remember the dates, but for them I do for some reason. So, you know, I figured I'd tell some maybe odd, funny, sort of quirky stories about them that are not in the history books first. That are not so serious. The first about Bach is, did you know, and I learned this not too long ago, that he actually spent an evening in prison. Yeah, he pulled a knife from an oboe player during a rehearsal. I tell my oboe playing friends. It's always the oboist, even back then. But in all seriousness, you know, Bach was quite religious. He was a music director in churches. He even taught Sunday school. He taught Latin even. That was among his duties. And he, you know, at the end of each piece he would write, dedicated to the glory of God. And I was thinking about this because the gavotte is a completely secular foray. It's a French Baroque dance. It has nothing to do with religion. But I came across this theory. It's a theory, I don't know, but it's a very interesting idea. That in the solo suites for cello and violin, of which Bach wrote a number of, that he had for each movement a distinct scene from the Bible, I think, or scene from Jesus' life for each of these movements. And it's maybe not true, but it's a fascinating way to think of it. If that's the case, for me, this is Palm Sunday, because it's triumphant. Violin version. Now I'll tell you about Rachmaninoff, who was Russian. He was, he was 6.5 feet tall. He had a shaved head. He never smiled in photos, at least, or maybe he never did. And again, he was Russian, so he was intimidating, let's say that. Somebody, I think it was Stravinsky, said he looked like an escaped convict. I don't know the prison that Bach to, but anyway. But I have a story about him that my grandfather actually met him in Richmond, Virginia in the 30s. My grandfather was no longer living. My grandfather was an usher at a recital that Rachmaninoff was giving. Can you imagine to go hear Rachmaninoff in Richmond? Nowadays, you're stuck with people like me, but Rachmaninoff. So my grandfather was told to guard doors, I guess like those. And so he stood there, but a few minutes went by and somebody tried to open the door. So my grandfather pushed back and then there was a little tug of war and then wham, the door was kicked open and it was Rachmaninoff. And you know what he said? He spoke to my, I tell you, he spoke to my grandfather. He said, get out of my way. So I had this personal, you know, connection the history of music. So I tell that story a lot and I just consider it as old. So here's the gavotte in the form of a rondo, it's called it, by Bach, arranged by Rachmaninoff. Some people like to shorten it to Bachmaninoff because it's just, you know, thank you. Paganini. I've been working through all the list arrangements of Paganini, so these are just two short ones. Paganini, who was born in the late 1700s, lived into the 19th century, was controversial. He was probably more like a rock star of today than how we think of a classical musician. There was a small group of people that believed he was possessed, as he wasn't. There was a group that was sure of that. Because he was so eccentric, even the way he looked, the way he played, his music did not really stem from any tradition. Like I mentioned Mozart earlier, Mozart learned a lot from his dad, who was a composer, and Bach learned a lot from his predecessors too. Heinrich Schütz, Buxtehude, Telemann, but Paganini, Ivor Gitlis, who's a violinist that I love, in that documentary, he said that Paganini was like the Big Bang in music, because it just came out of nowhere. And then the Romantics loved him and saw him as a model because of the virtuosity, the wildness, the improvisatory nature of his performances. So Franz Liszt, who was born in 1810, contemporary of Mendelssohn, he was actually at a kind of a low point in his life when he heard Paganini. He was in his 20s, living in Paris, which is not a bad place to be, but he was just kind of stuck. And he heard Paganini and he was so inspired that legend goes, and it's true, I think, that he locked himself up in a room to practice incessantly. While reading great literature, he also became a self-educated man at that time. And in several years, he emerged as the Franz Liszt that we remember. So the first thing he did in this period was arrange Paganini's violin music for the piano, some of it, chunks of it. And he actually did several versions. There's the first version, 1830-something, then he revised it, and I'm doing the version that was with some added things by a 20th century Italian composer, Ferruccio Busoni, 19th, 20th century. But at any rate, the first one I'm going to do is called La Chasse. It's from the 24 solo violin caprices. And La Chasse means the hunt. So it's called that because it's imitating the sound of hunting horn calls. And there's a lot of other classical music that emulates that you've heard. Necessarily hunting horns, but horns were used for hunting for ceremonial purposes, royalty, you know. There's a Mozart F major sonata that has that. Skip ahead. And I read somewhere that audiences at that time, when they would hear something like that, they would immediately note horn calls. It was just, they knew it. So that music can be sort of a language like that. I mean, we know certain things too. I mean, if we hear certain melodies or things, we understand the connotation. So but anyway, I wondered about why they used French horns or horns in hunting. I'm not a hunter, but I live in a rural area. I know some people hunt. So I may be wrong on this, but I have two thoughts. One is they didn't have cell phones, so they needed to know where the other hunters were. You know, we're over here. The other thought was, well, you couldn't walk into Walmart and buy a duck whistle. But I may be wrong, because I don't know if the horn calls would attract or repel the animal. You know, these are the things that drive me and my wife a little bit crazy, so never mind, I'll just play the piece. Thank you.
my watch because
I want to watch this. I don't want to overstay my welcome. So I'm half Russian. My mother's from Russia, from Moscow. But my other half is Southeast Virginia. Coming back, that's the grandfather that met Rachmaninoff. And I will say both traditions love to talk. And we went once to a gathering in Portsmouth, Virginia. It was a ceremony for a family friend who was retiring from a long-time job, and people got up to smoke. We got home 4 hours later. I was little, and I went to my mom and said, everybody talks as much as Dad. Maybe he's not a crazy actor. So, but anyway, let's see. Oh, I was going to do another Paganini. Okay. This one is based on the first of the 24 caprices. It's called the Arpeggio. And this one's unique because it's almost verbatim the same as the original violin piece. The other thing, you know, the violin doesn't play down here. That's a double bass. But this piece is all, you know, from there to there. And this makes it a little excruciating to play. Because for the violin, they do this with their bow. It's a ricochet motion, like that. But for the piano, I have to do this, bum, bum, bum. It's like fishing with a pencil. I don't know, it doesn't really work. So, but at any rate, I learned this piece, and usually when I learn a piece, I get some kind of an image or a story or something, or even the title will just lead to it. But this one, Arpeggio, I mean, I thought it was an exercise. It's not. But here's how it starts. I'll show you. And it just goes like that. So I asked my wife, who has so much wisdom and insight, and kept me from switching instruments and all these things. So I said, what do you hear? What do you imagine here? She said, oh, simple. We have two cats and two kids. So I tell people we have four kids, it means. So any cat lovers here, I have an older, not old, but regular age cat, and a very, very little kitten who's a little crazy. And this kitten has a toy, it's like a ball that goes around with a merry-go-round, it's just really obnoxious. And he whacks it and it comes around and he whacks it, and it's almost rhythmical, it's, you know, boom, boom. And she said, that's what I imagined when you played that. You know, and I can't see it any other way now. But I think that Paganini may have approved, because I think part of the key to his style is humor. And humor is often overlooked in classical music. It all has to be, you know. There are moments of humor in that piece too, by the way, but Beethoven had racism. But it's the tendency of, you know, everything serious. Well, this is, Paganini is not old. So maybe he would have been okay with the comparison. Here it is. Thank you. Dvorak, I would say, well, Paganini and Liszt were great musicians, and Franz Liszt was a great person. He had many great qualities. Paganini, maybe not so much, but long story. But at any rate, I would say the two of them were definitely not humble. That's for sure. Franz Liszt would go to royalty and give them his hand to kiss. Well, Dvorak, as I understand, was not like that. He was a sort of salt-of-the-earth person. And he loved especially folk music from his native Czechoslovakia, Czech Republic now, which he incorporated into his music. And he was just a whole different temperament. You'll see it in the music, you hear it, rather. Dvorak also spent considerable time in this country. He taught a generation of American composers in the late 19th century in New York. He spent a summer in Stillville, Iowa, of all places. There's a big Czech community there. And he happened to write his American string quartet there. And it's the New World Symphony. What a great piece. Listen to it all. It's, he incorporated into that symphony Native American, African American melodies that he had encountered here. And he told the young American composers, he said, the wealth of folk music in this country is just enormous. Use it as a reservoir for your compositions, so to speak. So this piece is an arrangement of a song, a vocal piece. Again, I don't sing, so well, I do, but you don't want to hear it. It's frequently played on the violin, so it counts. This is the songs my mother taught me from the Gypsy Songs by Dvorak. And there's so many versions of it. I recently heard Paul Robeson singing it in English. It was great. The words were something like, I remember the songs my mother taught me in the past, and now I'm teaching them to my children. It's very poignant, you know. So, yeah, and gypsy songs, gypsy music, it is the folk music of Central and Eastern Europe, and that's why it influences this too. So, here is a song my mother taught me, arranged for solo piano by a Russian composer named Edward Schut. It's a German name, but he was Russian apparently. Thank you. So should I strictly at 3 finish? Would that be best? Okay, I mean, it's up to you. If I go over a little, I won't go over too much. Okay, so this. I don't want to stay too long. So I started keeping a watch here. It's good to know because sometimes, you know, I lose track of time. The next is another piece by Dvorak. It's called Humoresque. It's a famous piece. And he wrote a number of them, and they're originally for piano. I didn't know that because you usually hear it on violin, this piece. There's a lot of great old recordings. I especially love Misha Elman. There's a video of him playing it from 1926. It's a whole different world. I'm not saying that I would have liked to live back then. There were many problems, of course, but there's some sort of a charm in that video, that performance that maybe is lost somehow. So, humorous obviously means something that's humorous, but this is the kind of humor that you'll see in Charlie Chaplin sometimes. It's not just, well, he can be laugh out loud funny, but there's a bittersweetness to it as well. And I think music especially can do that. It can capture two different, you know, sadness and laughter at the same time. So here is the humorous by Dvorak. Thank you. conversation. That's why I was asking about the 3 o'clock time, because that's where it might, you know. So this is a very short work by Spanish composer Isaac Albéniz. It's called Malagueña. This is a more famous Malagueña by Cuban composer Lecuona, so I want to get your hopes up. But maybe next time I'll do that one. But this is great, you know. Albéniz, who's actually Catalan, he was from near Barcelona, which is interesting because it's very different culturally from the south of Spain, where flamenco music is from. And what happened with Albéniz, he was a great pianist and composer. He was in Paris, which was the center, still is, a center of musical activity. But he didn't find his voice quite immediately. But it's when he started to draw from flamenco music that he found his musical style, his voice. And you know, flamenco music from the south of Spain, it's a melting pot of styles, as is the whole of Spanish culture, because Spain in the Middle Ages was Moorish, it was Arabic. And so there's this influence of that music. Flamenco music is in many ways a hybrid of, you know, music from Europe and from the Middle East, from Arabic music. You're gonna hear that in the opening. It sounds like a flamenco guitar or an Arabic lute, an oud, which is... sounds to me like a vocal part, you know, in the left hand. It's almost a sigh, I can't say, but in the middle, this takes over, there's like a vocal improvisation. Grew up in New Jersey, I forgot to mention that, so, you know, half Russian, half Virginian, it's odd. But anyway, there was a restaurant called The Taste of Spain, and that's what I call this. This is The Taste of Spain. It's a good restaurant, by the way. So, here it is, Malagueña by Isaac Albéniz. Thank you. 30 seconds of six of them. This is by Bella Bartok. It's called The Romanian Folk Dances. And this is probably the oddest piece on the program you're going to hear today. But as far as Bartok goes, and he was a pretty modernist composer at that time. You know, you have some modernist paintings in the back. Picasso, you know, was a contemporary. So. But as far as Bartok goes, this is pretty straightforward. I mean, you're going to hear some things like, you know. But if you like Texas Pete in your food, that's how I look at this. So, but I think that what's really notable with Bartok is obviously he was part of modernism in the 20th century, but he was also really invested in and pretty much obsessed with folk music. And he went out with his colleague and friend, Zoltán Kodály, another Hungarian composer, by the way, with an early tape recorder and recorded people singing folk songs in villages. This happened later. This ties into the gospel, because a lot of the gospel I'm doing is based on traditions, folk traditions, oral traditions in this country, some of which people like Alan Lomax had captured much later, but following in Bartok's footsteps, doing that. And this piece is based off of some Romanian folk songs that you heard and recorded. And Bartok especially loved Romania because, like Spain, it's a melting pot culture. The two main styles of music are gypsy music and klezmer, Jewish klezmer music. And there's a fusion of those styles. And how this all comes back to the violin, you know, the violin is a great folk instrument. Bluegrass in this country, you know, klezmer and gypsy music, it's all they use. Fiddle is the proper word for it. So anyway, these short dances, to me, they're like snapshots to village life in Romania. I haven't been there, but I imagine what it would be like. I'll announce the titles real quick. The first one is called Stick Game, which is, I guess, what kids did before the iPad. Then we have Peasant Costume, it's called. And that word peasant, I've learned, is in European cultures, it's not a derogatory word. In America, it is. I don't know, it's pejorative, but not in Europe. My Russian piano teacher, Vladimir Vyanadov, I can imitate him very well. Hello, Robert. And he actually had a story about it. So he would, this is where I learned the word peasants, you know, Russian culture was a good thing. So I was driving in, and I studied with him in Texas. He was there as he won the Van Cliver, and he was close to Van Cliver, and so ended up in Texas. And I used to drive him around, great pianist, and very Russian, and in Texas. And we're driving by, and he says to me, "Do you like this barrel full of crackers?" It took me a moment. "Oh, barrel full, you mean the cracker barrel?" I would never have expected you to know what that is. And I was surprised. I said, "Do you like it?" "Yes." "It is like Russian peasant food." So he explained to me that Russian, he said, I'm a peasant, it's good. So anyway, so that's the peasant costume. I went off on a tangent. The next one is a very eerie piece. It's called Standing Still. I imagine my head should slowly start turning. I was driving through Yanceyville recently at night, and there were some open fields, and I heard this piece in my mind. So, I mean, I love Yanceyville, but it was the middle of the night and it was dark. That's what I'm saying. So, no offense to Yanceyville. So, then we have Mountain Horn Song, which I would change the title to Klezmer Clarinet Lament. That's my title, but it's Mountain Horn Song. So then the last two are rather upbeat. This one is called Romanian Garden Gate. Very joyful. And then it segues into the last one called Little One. So here it is. It's just folk music from Romania, and it's a tradition, or traditions that have sadly died out since 150 years ago. But Bartok has kind of preserved it for us.
Thank you.
The last classical piece I'm going to play is Saint-Saëns' Étude en Forme de Valse, which means study in the form of a waltz, as we'd say in New Jersey. It's a sort of a waltz, and it's a sort of not a waltz. So Saint-Saëns was gifted in everything, it seems. He was not only a great composer and pianist, he was a child prodigy. There's a story about that later, but he was also an archaeologist, a mathematician, an Egyptologist, an animal rights activist in the 19th century, go figure. I mean, he was so many things, I don't know how he did it all. But there's a story I want to share about him when he lived a long time and grew up, he was younger than Liszt, but he was friends with Liszt and those people of that generation. And he lived into the 20th century, and I can tell you for a fact that he absolutely hated people like Bartok. So he walked out of the premiere of The Rite of Spring. Bassoon was playing this Ukrainian folk song on a high register. He walked out, Bassoon's not supposed to, I think he said something very off color. But anyway, Saint-Saëns, when he was 10 years old, gave his first recital in Paris. At the end of the recital, he said to the audience, this little kid, he said, "Which of the 32 Beethoven sonatas would you like me to play? I have them all memorized." What a brat.
Yeah, but this piece is comical, and that's what I love about I love the humor of this piece, because I think
that it would be perfect for a black and white silent movie, and it would be perfect for a Bugs Bunny and Elmer Fudd sequence, because the humor is in the contrast. It goes from being almost tender, like Bugs Bunny, Elmer Fudd trying to cozy up to Bugs Bunny.
No.
Bugs Bunny, I'm sorry, you know what?
And then out of the blue,
he plays with contrast and it's with expectations, and that's what makes this a comical piece, I think. So.
Thank you.
had to flip a switch in my head to do. So I haven't really planned what to do, because these are going to be some improvisations. How about I start with In the Garden? This is a Southern gospel twist on it.
So, if you need to go, please, no worries. So, this is a special request. I could do this gospel song.
Thank you.
softer one or more like upbeat? What's the...
Upbeat.
Okay, no, all right. So I haven't done this in a while. This is called Jesus Hold My Hand. I think I played it at the church back in October. This is by Albert E. Brumlin, who wrote I'll Fly Away also. So let's see. Well, I don't know. Christmas. I said to him, why? And he said, what do you mean? Russian Christmas is in January. So it works.
Thank you.
So.
Thank you.
okay. Yeah, we have the oh, yeah, right.
And the kid.
Well, it just turned 2 and 4, but a week or 2 hours ago, 1 and 3.
I was just wondering how your hand was holding up. That piano is not the world's best.
Well, it's not happening today.
Yeah.